start a new unit, digestion. Okay, chapter 23.
I'll start with my opening remarks
about digestion.
Food is often ingested in a chemical form that cannot, the small intestine cannot absorb. So to facilitate absorption, the GI tract digests food by both mechanical and chemical processes. So it gives students an orientation of the physiology. I'll start with this figure. To digest food, you put it through this tract that's simply a tube that starts at your mouth and ends in your anus. And things happen along the way that we'll learn about. And things are absorbed along the way to get the nutrients from the food you eat. Basically, the digestive system is gastrointestinal, or GI tract. From mouth to anus. When we talk about all the things along the tract, and even things that secrete stuff into the tract, okay, so you have the tract itself, a tube from mouth to anus. Then if you're something that is not in the tract, but you secrete things into it, you're called an accessory organ of digestion. Accessory organs of digestion. Are not part of the tract, but secrete things into it. Those things would be like, you know, saliva, enzymes, bile, things that help digestion. We'll get to that. So that's kind of what we study. Now the processes we study are listed here. Processes of digestion include ingestion. Simply means stick it in your mouth. You or somebody else, maybe you're being fed when you're a baby by your mother. Insert into oral cavity. Okay, mechanical digestion or fragmentation. That's simply, you're just pummeling the food, okay? You just break it apart. Pummel food. Breaking the big parts into littler parts, just mash it. It starts in your mouth, right? Where you got chompers, your teeth. So a large part of it is accomplished by the teeth. I'll just call them chompers. That's what they do. Also, your stomach. Your stomach, this churning of the stomach really gives it a lively pummeling as well. Chompers in your mouth, the stomach churning. But those two things right there, stomach, mouth, they accomplish a lot of the mechanical digestion. Just pummel it. Okay. So, that'll allow you to move the food along the digestive tract after it's been pummeled by your mouth and stomach. The key word is peristalsis for propulsion. Now, it's all color-coded here. You can see I kind of color-coded where these things occur. Like propulsion is light green, is like it occurs the entire way. When we study the digestive tract wall, you'll see, but peristalsis is a rhythmic contraction of the smooth muscle in the GI tract wall that moves food in one direction towards the anus. Rhythmic contraction of the smooth muscle in the GI tract wall. The goal is to move food. Now, you don't move food back towards your mouth. The goal is to move the food towards your anus. Okay. Move food in one direction. Move. Now, chemical digestion, I would say, is the true digestion, where you actually break things apart at the molecular level, not just mashing it, but like in mechanical digestion, but chemically digesting it. Digest food. You got to do is you got to kind of break your food, the polymers into monomers, so it's small enough to be absorbed. Well, a lot of that happens, it starts in the mouth. In the oral cavity, there's saliva that's secreted into the mouth. The saliva has enzymes like salivary amylase, as an example. It breaks down starches into simple sugars, so the process starts in the mouth. Saliva contains, amongst other things, salivary amylase. So enzymes can accomplish mechanical digestion. There's a lot of chemical digestion and mechanical digestion in the stomach. The stomach juices. The gastric juices, amongst other things, they contain good old HCl, that's a chemical, that'll break food up, and as well as pepsin, which will help digest proteins. So you got oral cavity, you got stomach, you also have, if you look at the picture there, they put acid drops to symbolize chemical digestion, and they put most of the acid drops, well, in the stomach, but right here, this is the duodenum. It's the first part of the small intestine after the stomach, because the duodenum receives secretions from the liver and the pancreas. So a lot of chemical digestion will occur because of the duodenum. So the duodenum receives secretions from liver slash pancreas. I'll tell you what the secretions are later. I spent a lot of time talking about them. So that's where a lot of it occurs. And so I would say most of it has been accomplished because of, by the time you get to the duodenum, all these secretions. Now, if there's things that still need to be digested, and you have to like move along the small intestine, so 21 feet of small intestine after duodenum. There's what are what we call the brush border enzymes that line the epithelial cells of the small intestine. They can accomplish more chemical digestion. I'll mention them too. Small intestine, brush border enzymes, what those are. Remember, a simple columnar epithelium typically has microvilli that look like a brush border. And in there are enzymes that digest food. They'll finish off the chemical digestion so you can then absorb it, which is basically the next function. Once you've accomplished most of the chemical mechanical digestion, now you can absorb the food. Absorption of, keyword is absorption, of food stuff from GI tract. If you don't take it out of the GI tract, it ends up in your feces. You say it passes right through you. So you can absorb from the food stuff, from the tract, it's moving along the tube, take it out of there, either into intestinal capillaries, or lacteals. Lacteals are lymphatics. That's why they have a red tube and a green tube. It's a lymph vessel. Because lacteals will absorb fats. The fat globules are too big to make through make it inside the intestinal capillaries, but usually the lacteals can absorb them. Okay, so, this happens in the intestine. That's why I said intestinal capillaries. You got 21 feet of tube to absorb your meal. And what does not absorb? Things that are not digestible, like fiber and other things. They make it to, for defecation, they make it to the rectum anus. Well, the feces, what you defecate, is basically things that were not absorbed. It just passed right through you. The brown color of feces is usually due to the bilirubin from the liver. But yeah, basically when it gets to the rectum is a holding chamber for the feces. Rectum is like the distal end of the colon. Holding chamber for the feces. Rectal walls distend, that triggers a defecation reflex. So when you stretch the walls, they contract. That's the reflex. So the reflex is stretch or distend rectal walls. Feces are doing it. And then you contract and you push the feces toward the anal canal. Extend rectal walls. Reflexively contract push feces towards the anal canal. Now, surrounding the anal canal, I know you don't have a picture of it here. That's when you feel like you got to go. Okay, when that sensation of having to go is because of that. The rectal walls are contracting. And then you have a sphincter. You have a couple of sphincters here that surround the anal canal. There's an external anal sphincter that's, you know, external sphincters are voluntary muscle. So like, that kind of helps you hold it in until you decide to go to the restroom. Right? So when you do this, then the external anal sphincter contracts. So you don't have an accident, right? And then when you actually decide to go, the sphincter would relax, you contract them, other muscles to push it out, to eliminate the waste. And you can take a long piece of string and stick it in your mouth and just keep swallowing it. And eventually it'll come out the other end, right? I don't do that, but I've seen people do it. Kind of funny to think about, but that's what it is. It's just a tube right through your body. Okay. Now the first thing we do is we study the structure of this tube, because it's pretty much the same from mouth to anus, and we'll study it in four locations: in the esophagus, the stomach, the small intestine, and the large intestine. Okay, that's the challenge of your pathology. But here's the general pattern of wherever you study it. There's some differences I'll mention. Before I describe the wall, understand there's a lumen, the space where food passes through, right? Food passes along, passes by, however you want to put it. Now the structure, the innermost structure, is called a mucosa, like it commonly is. Let me kind of zoom in on it. Pretty much it's kind of like from there to there with the blue line. This is the mucosa. Okay, and all these things here you have to know. The GI tract is lined, the mucosa is lined with an epithelium. Now, the epithelium, the kind of epithelium, it changes, so it's kind of too hard to say. Generally speaking, it's a stratified squamous epithelium at the beginning and at the end. And everywhere else in between, it's kind of like a columnar epithelium, depending on the function. Changes depending on function. I'll just kind of, when I go through the histology slides, I'll define all the epitheliums you got to know. So there's a lamina propria underneath the epithelium. It's a connective tissue. Now what's unique about the GI tract, the mucosa has its own muscle layer. If you look at the picture there, I mean, this is a smooth muscle layer surrounding the mucosa. You usually don't see muscle in the mucosa. You usually only see epithelium. But remember, the job of the GI tract, the function is to move food along. So it helps to have like an inside layer of muscle to kind of increase the agitation of the food. So there's a muscularis mucosa. A smooth muscle layer in the mucosa increases food agitation. So that's what I'll say about that. It's commonly missed. Students have a tough time with this one, this layer here, because it's the only system where you have a muscle layer in the mucosa. That's what I think. I don't know why anyone's missing. So just start next to that one. Don't miss it. The mucosa has its own muscle layer. Now, the layer outside of it from there to there, that layer there. This is the submucosa. It's just loose connective tissue. Loose CT. Now, when we do the histology for this, there are some things in the submucosa you should be able to identify. Let's see. Well, you know, they have this little green thing here in the mucosa. They call it mult. I usually see it here. Okay. So let's note mult as something to identify in the submucosa. Now, I already taught you this. It stands for mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. Now, if you've forgotten, I go back and look in your lymphatic notes. There's also, in the duodenum only, there's something called Bruner's glands in the submucosa. It's in the duodenum. Bruner's glands. Spelled Brunner's, you pronounce it Bruner's. They have an alkaline secretion to neutralize the acid coming from the stomach so you don't get an ulcer there. Alkaline secretion. Neutralize stomach acid. There's a lot of things here in the loose connective tissue. One of the things, all the yellow are nerves, right? Just call them submucosal plexus. They're nerves. Found in this layer. Submucosal plexus. Okay, that's it for submucosa. Move on to the layer outside of that. External to that is a layer called muscularis externa. I'll just kind of put it right there, another line from there to there. Okay, I'm drawing all these blue lines. Again, what layer of the wall is this? Mucosa from here to here. Submucosa, and these two layers are called the muscularis externa. The muscle layer. It's the main muscle layer. I mean, you have muscle layer in the mucosa too. So this is the main part of the GI tract that accomplishes the peristalsis I mentioned earlier. Okay, do you see how there's two layers? Now I'm going to note them because I'll have you identify them. See the inner, this inner layer is kind of like more circular, like it kind of surrounds, the cells are orientated circularly around the GI tract, so it's a circular layer. It's the inner layer usually. So I just call it inner circular layer. Muscular cerebra. And the one outside of that, if you look there, like the smooth muscle cells, they run longitudinally along the length of the tube. So we call that the longitudinal layer. So we'll call it outer longitudinal layer. Outer longitudinal layer of muscularis excreta. So I'll have you identify one or the other. And notice in between the muscle layers right here, you have more nerves to help them contract, and that's let's call them the myenteric plexus. Okay, so identify that as something to identify for muscularis externa. Outside of that is a serosa or adventitia. Hard to highlight, it's just kind of trace a little bit. It's kind of this layer all the way around. And the thing about it is this layer, do you see how like it kind of pinches? Like right there? Kind of trace them with the blue. Here, all wrapping all the way around. So they call it a serosa or adventitia. It's the outer wrapping of the digestive tract. I think more often you'll see it in your book called a serosa. Sometimes refer to it as adventitia, the outermost layer of ad. T-I-T-I-A. It's like an external wrapping. Now, where it kind of wraps around the organ and kind of pinches right there, you call it a mesentery. Forms mesentery. Also forms visceral peritoneum. So it's like, pretend this is like the back body wall. Black line. And imagine you have a piece of intestine here. So it's like the peritoneum comes along, it lines the back of your body wall. The peritoneum that lines the body cavity, it's called the parietal peritoneum. This layer. And then pretend like to hold the organs in place, there's a piece of it that comes out and wraps around the organ. Okay, the part that wraps around the organ is the visceral peritoneum, the serosa. Okay. And then the part that pinches right there, that's the mesentery. It anchors the organs to the back body wall, pretty much. Mesenteries anchor organs to back body wall. It has other functions too. I mean, look at the picture. There's stuff in it, right? There's arteries, veins, nerves, lymphatics. You have to have a mechanism to like get these things to the organs. I mean, that's what's inaccurate about studying these things in torsos. Torsos give you an inkling of what these things look like and how they're arranged, but they don't do the mesenteries. Okay, you have to study real cadavers to get a true sense of how the organs are arranged in the body cavity. All right, so any questions on those terms? The peritoneum stuff, what a mesentery is, I'll move on. So those are the layers of the digestive tract wall. I gave you a couple of nerve plexuses to understand. The myenteric plexus and the submucosal plexus. And I'm just pointing to them. You don't have to know the details of this. I just want you to know that these plexuses form what's called the enteric nervous system. We really don't teach this very much. When you take 430 and you learn about the organization of the nervous system, we teach, you know, the sensory division, we teach the motor, we teach the somatic and the autonomic a lot, but not so much ENS, but so I at least want to mention it. Kind of like the mini brain of the digestive tract. Think about it. The only thing you do voluntarily when you eat is to swallow your food, chew your food, swallow your food, right? But after that, what happens? It's a mystery. It takes care of itself, right? The digestive process, because of this nervous system. Of course, you take care of when it gets to the end, right? You excrete it, and take care of that too. But everywhere in between is this, the ENS. I'll just say simply that the ENS is comprised of what I mentioned before, the submucosal myenteric plexuses. See from the picture, it does interact with the parasympathetic and the sensory divisions. Well, anyways, if we look at this model, we can kind of see everything I just talked about. So you have to pick somewhere in the digestive tract to study. This is the small intestine.
one of the ways you can tell is if you look at the mucosa, those finger-like projections at the top, those villi, little lady finger here. Villi means finger-like projection. That's number one. Two, it's pointing to a green thing inside the villi. What system is like they use green? You guys remember? The green system.
Lymphatics.
Lymphatics. That's lacteal, the thing that absorbs the fat from the food you ate. We're going to eat on Thanksgiving. Number three, they're red, going for intestinal capillaries, also in the villi. So there's another intestinal capillary that I like better, and it's surrounding the lacteal. It's hard to see on. See right here, it's like goes from red and then to blue to show the gas exchange. So that's one too. Okay, and I actually like that one better. So you know what that means, right? I like it better. Okay, number four, what are they pointing to? Okay, I think four is pointing to this gray area. I think the gray here kind of represents what I call lamina propria. You know, they don't mention the epithelium. Maybe number one is going for epithelium, I don't know. But you see this epithelium here? There is a columnar epithelium with goblet cells. All those like little gray dots, those are goblet cells in the small intestine. So I'll just kind of write it there. You know, I don't know if there's something that's actually pointing to it. But is it there? You should know it. Columnar ET with the goblet cells. Number five here. Trying to go in order. Four. No, five was five. Okay, I don't see that below. Oh, look at that. 15. See that little dip right there? So here's what I want you to see. Maybe you're not seeing it yet. It's like you got the mucosa, and it's like you got things that stick up and then pits that go down. See that? Villi, the finger that sticks up, but the pit that goes down is called the crypts of Lieberkuhn, and there's pan cells in there. Crypts of Lieberkuhn, it's got the weird dot over it, with pan cells. The pan cells are eosinophilic, they usually stain red. So this is the arrangement of the mucosa in the small intestine. So number 15 is the crypt. Okay, I'll just go from top to bottom. Looks like they skipped some numbers. See what number 9 is pointing to? It's the thing you miss. What did I say that is?
Muscularis
mucosa. Yeah, it's the one you guys miss a lot. So let's write into that. Muscularis mucosa is one here. It's the bottommost layer of the mucosa. Deep to that is submucosa. Okay. Now you got some things here in the submucosa. I guess seven is like, it's pointing to yellow lines in the submucosa, that's submucosal plexus. T, that's the lymphoid tissue there, I want you to know.
Nebulae.
11 is small. 10. It doesn't look like anything. If you look at it from the side, you work with the models right there. Got two of them. It's the Bruner's glands. The Bruner's glands that I mentioned earlier. Oh, before I erase this, I don't know if you noticed, at the bottom of the pit are these, like, these little red cells. Do you see them on the... Let me zoom in, right? I'll show you what I mean. At this angle, they're difficult to see. You see a tip of red, like right there? Patent cell, okay? They made them red for a reason. So if I point right to there, and I say identify cell, I'm going for the patent cell. They have a secretion that helps kind of die for the absorptive process in the small intestine. Okay, I'm going to erase it now. Crypts of Leprechaun, patent cell. Sorry, let's see what else. I did 11. Okay, 10 was Bruner's glands. Spelled runners. So the myenteric plexus. Okay, what else? All right, 12A and B are the two layers of the muscularis externa. So 12A is that inner circular layer, and the B is the outer longitudinal layer. And 13 is the myenteric plexus in between the two layers. Okay, so 12A, inner circular layer of, just to be quick, I'm going to abbreviate it MM because I wrote it out before. And you don't get to use that abbreviation for the test, just you spell it out. Gotta be quick here. So 12B is the outer longitudinal layer. I'm sorry. It should be ME, shouldn't it?
Yeah.
Thank you. Muscularis externa, muscularis externa, 12A and 12B. 13 is the myenteric plexus. Now the 13, there's a 14 right after at the very bottom here. Right, it's hiding down there, maybe you can't see it, but that's basically just serosa. Okay, so 14 is serosa. So that's a good model to study. It's like it's got everything, most things. We'll move on. We have other models in the room that show the layering. Now, this one, let me see if I can find it back there. Because like you guys, like maybe you study this, but you don't know where it came from. So let me show you. All right, so this is that. So this is going to be on your practicals. And this little thing that they windowed out here, they got the layers right there. And sometimes students ignore it. But so I made this slide. I know it's a little blurry, but it shows the layers there. So study the GI tract layers on this one for small intestine. And for the large intestine, this picture here, it goes with this one here. So that's where this came from. The layers are right there, so study this for the layers.
for your lap time. Okay, more about mesentery. There's some actual anatomical names for some of the mesenteries you gotta know in your study guide. So again, to give you an idea, I kind of like did a longitudinal view of this. This is kind of like a sectional view. So you're looking inside the peritoneum. We're studying the body cavity, the peritoneum. It's pretty important to digest your digestive viscera here. I've heard that the military developed a procedure. If you have a brain injury and you have to remove a part of the skull, they take that skull that they removed and they insert it in the peritoneum during the surgical procedure to keep it safe. Because it's a sterile environment and the fluids in there provide nourishment for the skull tissue. Hopefully, you'll never need that. Then you put the skull back on when you're done with brain surgery. Anyways, the peritoneum is a sterile environment. So we say things are intraperitoneal, and we say things are retroperitoneal. Okay, so I kind of want to introduce those terms. So they kind of draw, well, they just cut the body right here. So I think of the spine posteriorly as they should. Then they have this here, like that. And then they're gonna have, like I drew in blue. An organ that's intraperitoneal. It's simply in the peritoneal cavity. It's in there. Okay, and you can see how it's suspended. They have a membrane that kind of lines the body cavity. I'm gonna leave a space there. So what if we call this peritoneum, the one that lines the body cavity?
Parietal.
The parietal peritoneum, right? Doesn't help you write it yet. So you now know the three P's of anatomy, the peritoneum, the pericardium, and the pleura. Okay. It's the visceral one. And what do we call that?
Mesentery.
Mesentery is correct. Okay, if something gets pushed behind the body wall, right, like this thing, okay, it's definitely behind the peritoneum. They call that retroperitoneal. Things like your kidneys, your aorta, your part of the duodenum, part of your digestive tract is. Okay, well anyways, that's the idea of what a mesentery is, the peritoneums, intra and retro. Let's move on. Here's a sagittal view of why I like this, because it shows some of the mesenteries you actually have to know about your study guide. So let me kind of, can I erase this? Okay, can I erase it now? Okay. Well, I don't know. It's all, everything's on YouTube, right? Just go and look it up. Alright, so let's orient ourselves. Here's the spine, which you can call them posterior or anterior. It's, you know, sagittal plane, right? Probably mid-sagittal. So, it's like you got. And I'll just sketch it, OK? Okay, I'll sketch, but I'm gonna make it a little bigger. Exaggerate, because I have to draw. Okay, so it's like you got your diaphragm on top. You got liver right there. And below that, you got stomach. Below that, you got transverse colon. Transverse colon. So you also have duodenum and pancreas that are going to be retro. Oh, then they got like a bunch of small intestine, jejunum, ileum. I'll just cut it. Okay, we have to kind of learn how all this stuff is back body wall. So let me draw the peritoneum, the parietal peritoneum. So my blue line is my parietal peritoneum. It's like the underneath of the diaphragm up here. And so I'm going to shoot down. I'm going to shoot it over the liver. And then it's also going to line this part here. There. So let's continue with the liver. Notice how you have visceral peritoneum all around the liver. But there's a little spot, like a little bald spot. They call that the bare area of the liver. It's not covered with peritoneum. Bare area. No peritoneum. So here's right there. Okay, there's a mesentery that shoots down from liver to stomach. It goes around the stomach. There's a big fat apron. It's going to come all the way down, all the way back. Got it right. Okay, now I'm going to draw it over here. The mesentery that comes out this way, and all the intestines. Go ahead. If you're drawing, I'll give you some time to draw it. It helps me to draw it. I mean, I just drew that. You can just study the picture if you want, but most people It helps you to kind of sketch it out yourself, get a better idea what it is. I'll name the mesenteries. You're supposed to know in the name. All right, the mesenteries you gotta know are this one. Who's black? Circle this one there, it's the column number one. That's the lesser omentum. It's called that because, well, you can't tell here, I mean, it goes from liver to stomach, right? This curvature of the stomach, it's called the lesser curvature of the stomach. So hence the name, lesser omentum. Okay. This one here, this big fat apron, is the greater omentum because this greater omentum, that's the greater curvature of the stomach, but it goes from there to the transverse colon. Okay. So, I mean, you open the body cavity, usually this is one of the first things I see, the greater omentum. It's a good place for fat depot. Okay, this one back here, it attaches the transverse colon to the back body wall. That is the transverse mesocolon. All right, this one back here, it's called the root of the mesentery. All right, I'm gonna move away from that picture and start to show you other pictures that kind of show these things. Turn the lights off a little. So here's a frontal view. Again, goes from liver to stomach there. So that thin membrane there is the lesser omentum. Here's the greater curvature of the stomach. Here's the lesser curvature of the stomach, hence the name. Lesser omentum, greater omentum. So this big fat apron is the greater omentum. Imagine lifting this fat apron up, and underneath you would see this. That's the transverse colon. Here's other pictures of these mesenteries. There's the duodenum and the pancreas. Duodenum, pancreas. Here's transverse colon. Here's greater omentum, the yellow. So, here's if you lift the fat apron up, identify. Transverse colon. But right there is transverse mesocolon. There and there. Okay, transverse mesocolon. All right, so that's enough about mesentery. Let's kind of do what I say, take a survey of the GI tract. Let's start at the mouth. The end of the anus, obviously we won't make it to the end today, but let's start with the oral cavity. Now we can do this when we come back from break. That's a good place to start. So take a break now.